Good morning, Heritage. Good to see all of you this morning. I tell you, we have quite a few of our church family members that are either ill or injured. So, you know, it is the season of flu and colds, right? So you might want to give air hugs this morning to each other instead of a hug. What I'd like you to do is find your hymnal. That's the red book in front of you, under the seat, and turn to page 66. Because what we're gonna do something really different this morning. We don't have any instrumentalists, and so we're gonna sing. Well, no, that's right. This morning, Connie Williams, yay, has graciously said she would play piano for us. So that's good. We have one instrument. Anyway, find page 66, and right after a video, then I'd like you to join us in singing To God Be the Glory. We're just going to sing one verse of that. So let us pray and lift up our family members to God, our Father, okay? Lord, we just thank you for this day that we can come and worship you. We thank you that we who are here are well. And we just thank you for health. Lord, I pray for those who are injured or ill this morning, and that was why they can't come, or just those that have to stay home for whatever reason. I pray that you would just let them feel your nearness this morning. Let them realize that you are right there with them and that they can worship you right in their home, right where they are. Lord, we thank you so much that you matter to us. So just remain seated, and we're going to watch a video.
To the broken and to the hurting, to the desperate and to the defeated, to the common, the average, the plain and the small, I want you to know, you matter to God. To the washed up and the worn out, to the helpless and the hopeless, to the cast outs, the dropouts, the last picks and hypocrites, to the unimpressive and the underwhelming, to the nobodies and has-beens, to people just like me, you matter to God. You are not defined by your worst days or your biggest mistakes. And you're not the sum total of all your setbacks, slip-ups, failures, and faults. Because who you are is not determined by what you have, where you've been, or what you've done, but who Jesus declares you to be. You matter to God. Maybe at some point somebody told you something that simply wasn't true. That you're nothing but unworthy, unwanted, and unloved. But I want the loudest voice in your ear to be the voice that breaks the cedars and shakes the wilderness, and he says, you matter to me. Before the galaxies were born, or the first star gave light, before the ocean waves crashed, or the night sky cracked with thunder, before any creature crawled, or any bird sang, before the planets were set in motion, he set in motion the plan of your salvation. From the highest heights of heaven, the Lord of all creation looked upon your desperation. He became like one of us to remake all of us, to make an orphan his child, to make a rebel his friend, to set the prisoner free. You matter to God. So to all the sons and daughters of God, to all my brothers and sisters in Christ, behold his power and glory and majesty. Behold the one who matters most.
Okay, Connie.
Sin. Amen. Thank you. You only get one verse of that today. Last weekend, 20 of our people, 17 high school students and 3 adult leaders went up to Hume Lake and had a great experience. I've asked some of them to share about that, so I'd like JR and Mike Gonzalez and April, one of the students, they're each going to share. Following their sharing, we have a short video to show as well. So who's starting? Is it JR?
Good morning, church. Good morning. Last weekend, as Jim said, we took 20 people to Hume Lake High School winter camp. We didn't realize it until we had gotten up there, but it was really different this year because we only, out of the 20, only 4 of us had been to that camp before, which normally it's reversed. Normally we only have 4 newbies and, you know, everyone else is the alum. So that was super interesting. And the speaker at the counselor meeting the first night, he talked about having a divine appointment with God. And we just saw that to be the case with this group for sure. They fully immersed themselves in all the fun activities. The speaker and the production was amazing. And for me, my moment really came on Sunday morning. We were singing Christ Be Magnified, and I just started crying because I'm so grateful for the work that God is doing in youth ministry here at Heritage and these kids. Make no mistake about it, you might not see them in the pews on Sunday morning because of their life situations are all different. But God is using Heritage to build a generation of Christians, no doubt about it. And through this transition, he's working so much. These kids are on fire for Jesus, and it's so exciting to witness. So this is my girl, April. She is a senior at Highland, and she loves Jesus, and she is going to tell you what she learned and experienced.
Hi, my name is April Hernandez, and while at our stay at Hume, we went over the book of Jonah. Okay. So, what I learned from the book of Jonah is that God's forgiveness is unconditional, and it is for everyone. In Jonah chapter 1, verse 2, God says to Jonah, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me." And instead of doing what God said to do, Jonah went the opposite direction. He went off to the city of Tarshish. The speaker, Austin Payne at Hume Lake, explained it as if God were to tell you to go to San Francisco, but instead you make your way to Tijuana, Mexico, which are opposite directions. And at first it was unclear to why Jonah would have done this. Maybe he was scared of the people in Nineveh since they were known to dislike Israelites. But as we read, we get the real answer. Continuing on with the story, Jonah's on a boat making his way to Tarshish. God hurled a great wind upon the sea in order to put a halt to Jonah's travels. The rest of the people on the boat became afraid. In Jonah chapter 1, verse 7, they said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots, that we may know on whose account this evil has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lots fell on Jonah. Jonah told them everything and how he disobeyed God. And Jonah then told them to throw him into the sea, and so they did. In later verses, we read, "Then the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and 3 nights. While in the belly of the fish, Jonah prayed to God, recognizing what he did and bringing thanksgiving to the Lord for still being there with him. The Lord told the fish to vomit Jonah back out. Jonah was back on dry land." And then chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, we read, "The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, 'Arise, go out to Nineveh, the great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you.' Jonah finally went to Nineveh and called out, 'Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown.' Then the people of Nineveh heard this, and they believed God." In later verses, we read, "When God saw what they did and how they turned from the evil ways, God relented of the disaster that he said he would do to them, and he did not do it." Shockingly, this displeased Jonah, and he became angry. In chapter 4, verses 2 to 3, Jonah is praying to God in anger, and he says, "This is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Therefore, now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than live." And from chapter 4, we realize the real answer why Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh in the first place. He already knew how loving and forgiving our God was. Jonah believed that the people of Nineveh didn't deserve God's forgiveness. But if that's the case, Jonah should realize that neither did he deserve God's forgiveness. Because as it says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." But this is where God's love and mercy comes to act. That when he died on the cross, that he didn't just die for one person, he didn't just die for me or you, but he died for all of us. So instead of running and trying to hide God's forgiveness like Jonah did, we should be the ones who spread it and share God's love and glory. So what I learned from the book of Jonah is that God's love and forgiveness is unconditional and it is for everyone.
I think I'm just going to sit down now. It was my first time, and I've dropped the kids off there before, and it was cold, but, you know, I just jumped back in my car and drove home. I was fine. But living there 3 days, I was, like, bone cold. I had, like, 5 layers on, my big poncho. I had bought gloves and beanies and a couple beanies at a time and my hood on, and I was still cold. But it was great, so I kind of made the effort, like whatever the boys wanted to do, I said, "Whatever you guys want to do, let's do it." So we signed up pretty much for everything. All the kids did, the girls and the boys. We did the escape room. That was fun. The boys beat the girls, just so you guys know. 20 seconds, yeah, 20 seconds. And then we played re-ball, which is like paintball, but the balls are hard and rubber. And I was like, it's not going to be that bad. And I probably still have bruises from this game, but the next day I woke up and I was like, my leg is, what is going on? And I had a welt right here. One of the kids shot me. But it was great the whole time. Like we made an effort to say, like, if you're going to do anything, do it at least groups of three, stay together, this and that. But we literally did groups of like everybody. We would, like, the boys would break up and we'd all come back together when it was all the boys and all the girls. And then sometimes it was like boys and girls, and it was just great. We had such a great time. It was good to see, like, we had a lot of new kids that made the affirmation to say, like, they're going to follow Christ. And what was really cool is a lot of our kids, they're already believers, but it was good to see them, like, it almost was like that. They kind of, I don't want to say stagnant, but, you know, you just go through life and just daily things. But then to see that fire just kind of build in them again. And that was just great to see. It's always good to have a little fire inside you to keep you going. And then I had one boy who was non-believer. He just, first time doing anything like this. And he just kept asking questions. And at the end of it all, he still wasn't sure if this is what he wanted to do or what he believed in. But I told him, it doesn't always just happen right away. You know, sometimes it's just a small spark, and, you know, it's not the same for everybody. But I go, you know how a fire starts? It's just a small spark. So he, you know, kind of like, he thought about that for a little bit. So I'm going to keep in contact with that kid. He's on a good track. But yeah, it was just an amazing time. I mean, for the kids, it was amazing. For me, it was great. Just the speakers that we had, the counselors, it was just an amazing time. The red coats, what they call, like, all their counselors up there. I mean, they're so interactive with you. You could just be walking by yourself, and they'll jump in your crowd and, "Hey, what are you guys doing? You want some hot chocolate? Let's go. There's free coffee over here." And it was great. I love the free hot chocolate. And then the sled, we didn't put a video together or anything. We did? Oh, okay. It was great. So Yeah, you'll watch the video of the sled. Our sled survived this year. So one of the boys fell off. But yeah, that was probably the funnest thing we did that night, was just the sled and seeing these crazy cardboard things that these kids made up. It's just cardboard and duct tape. And some of them didn't quite make it all the way down, and some of them went super fast. It was scary how fast they went. And there's like a jump that's like, you know, about a foot and a half tall that they have to come down this huge hill and make the jump. And some kids just exploded as soon as they hit the ground. But it's such a good time. No one got hurt. Everybody fell. You'd just be walking normal, and out of nowhere, someone's on the floor, and it was a good time. But it would just, you just laughed it off, and yeah, it was great. So I thank you guys for sending me. Thank you, JR, for inviting me. But amazing. I'm going in again in a couple weeks. The junior high camp, yeah.
And that's one thing that's really funny, because I've been going to Hume Lake Winter Camp since 1983. So, you know, it's all old stuff for me. But to hear someone just have such great experience and be new, and all that excitement is just so much fun. So we do have a video that the girls put together for you. So enjoy.
Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
Thank you, JR, Mike, April. Okay. Yeah, I've been involved with the youth group the last few weeks. And pray for me. I'm speaking this Wednesday, sharing my testimony in the following week. And it's been fun to be part of the youth group and working with the youth leaders there. And so that's been encouraging. I've asked Cynthia if she would share a few announcements. I wiped off the...
Oh, you did?
I did.
All right. Good morning, I'm Cynthia. We're going to look at a short video introducing our new Bible study for women's ministry called Elijah by Priscilla Schreier. So we'll just watch that right now.
If there was ever a time where the sons and daughters of God needed to rise up in the spirit of Elijah, that time is right now. More and more, people are forgetting who our God is, that he is who he has always declared himself to be, and he can still do exactly what he said he can do. God's hand is on you, not just the missionary, not just the pastor, not just the Sunday school leader. God's hand is on you right where he has placed you to be used for his purposes and his glory. Because we operate by the power and the presence and the discernment of the Spirit of God, we should still be able to live in alignment with the promises that our God has declared to us.
So I think that looks pretty good, and I hope that we get a lot of women joining us Wednesday. We will be meeting at 6:30 in room 55. And all women are welcome. So please join us. And also Wednesday, we're going to have a great meal served. We baked potatoes with all the toppings, with chili beans, green salad, and dessert. And also there's for all first-time visitors, we have a gift that will be at the information booth. Roger will be back there to help you select one. And even people who haven't been here in a long time, Joella and, yeah. Also, our giving off options. Since we don't pass our offering bags anymore, you can use the offering boxes in the foyer to either put your offering in, or you can mail it to the church. There's an app on your phone that's pretty easy to access. You can also use that. And so that's all our announcements.
Let me go ahead and just pray for our offering before we dismiss children. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to give and return to you that which you have first given to us. We recognize you are the owner. We're simply the stewards. We're managers of what you have already provided to us. And so we give in recognition of your leadership and sovereignty in our lives. Use it for your kingdom and your glory through our giving. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. At this time, we want to go ahead and dismiss children with Jen Gonzalez, children up through sixth grade to Heritage Kids. So as they are trickling out to the center aisle, let me encourage the rest of you, stand and greet. And if you don't want to hug somebody, get close and wave, okay? Take a couple minutes and greet those around you.
All right, yes, you can stand with us now. We're gonna do something a little bit different this morning. I've asked several people, didn't mean to blast your ears out. I've asked several people to read this morning's scripture in segments. So between each segment, we're going to sing a verse of Amazing Grace. So let me see, what else do I need to tell you? I think that's it. So David Newton will be reading our first scripture right after we sing the first verse of Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you have known it completely, O Lord. You hem me in, behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, is too lofty for me to obtain.
Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark for you. The night will shine like the day, for the darkness is as light to you.
For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you.
If only you would slay the wicked, O God, away from me, you bloodthirsty men. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord, and abhor those who rise up against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them as my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of the everlasting.
Annette and I had the chance to go visit with Steve and Diane Schnitzler yesterday to pray for Diane. As many of you know, Diane experienced a serious accident when hit by a car and smashed her knee and lower part of her leg. Well, in 3 months' time, the bones have not begun to heal and restore and rebuild. I mean, many years ago, I broke both my legs in a car accident, and they were all clean breaks, and so the legs mended. But for Diane, that hasn't occurred yet. And so I'd had lunch with Steve last week, and I said, we really want to come over and just pray for you and Diane. And so we did that yesterday morning and anointed her with oil and just spent time and pray. And I want to encourage you to really lift her up and really pray that at this point, God would miraculously restore and heal her. And that's what we want to pray for, that God would be glorified. And God would provide that restoration and that healing. And so appreciate that and just join us in prayer for that. One last item I want to remind you about, if you'll notice on the back of your bulletin, in 2 weeks is our annual church meeting. And so right after the worship service, we will gather in the social hall at 11 o'clock. There'll be a light lunch served. We'll review some of the ministry highlights from this last year. We'll talk about the direction that youth ministry is going as we make plans to transition this next year, move on from JD. And we have some news to share with you. And so we'll be sharing that with you in a couple of weeks. So make sure you plan on joining us, and we look forward to that. Okay? Well, our message today is on the passage you just had read to you, Psalm 139. It's entitled, God is Too Much for Me. I encourage you to open your Bibles, even though it's just been read. I encourage you to turn in your Bibles to Psalm 139. I will refer to various verses and encourage you to look at that. There is a sermon outline on the church app, as well as copies that were passed out. And there are some blanks to follow. As I told somebody, take one of these sermon outlines. There's blanks to fill in. It'll help keep you awake as you try to follow along or guess what the words are. One author, in his commentary on Psalm 139, made this comment about that well-known chapter. I'll put it up on the screen for you. The author is Derek Kidner. He said, any small thoughts that we may have of God are magnificently transcended by this psalm. Yet for all its height and depth, it remains intensely personal from first to last. It's been interesting as I was reading different commentaries. There were a number of commentators, and this surprised me, really, to be honest. There were a number of commentators that thought the focus of Psalm 139, they thought it was written because the writer, presumably David, had been accused of sin or wrongdoing, and so the psalm was his prayer of seeking and declaring innocence before God and seeking vindication. And as I thought about that, to be honest, I don't agree with those writers. I don't agree with those commentators. I think if the writer is David, as you read through Psalm 139, he's not, you know, confessing sin and seeking forgiveness. I think he is, he's just declaring the marvels of God. For example, you know, he starts and he says, God knows everything. And then in verse 6, such knowledge is too wonderful for me. He then talks about the fact that God is everywhere, and yet God leads him. And lastly, he talks about the fact that God has created him, has ordained his days for him. He concludes that section by saying, how precious are your thoughts toward me? David is writing this psalm. He is just amazed at God, amazed at his powers, at his knowledge. In a sense, God is far beyond anything that he can imagine or understand. And that's why I think God would say, God is too much for me. Let's go ahead and examine this psalm in more detail. Interestingly, the psalm is conveniently divided into four sections, with each section being six verses, and each section describes a different attribute of God. Verses 1-6 describe God's perception of me, and that's your first blank, God's perception of me. And in these verses, we just read about the fact that God knows everything about us. Theologians have a term for this called omniscient, which means God is all-knowing. Jesus said the same thing in the New Testament when he uttered during one of his teachings that God knows the numbers of hairs on your head. If we look at Psalm 139, verse 1 says, "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me." And then look at the end of the psalm, verse 23. Once again, David says, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts." Each time it's a reference to God searching us. And those two verses, verse 1 and verse 23, they're like bookends to the entire psalm. Because God searches us, he knows all of our thoughts, knows all of our actions, knows all of the words that before we even utter them. And David illustrates the fact that God knows everything by referring to opposites. He says, "You know when I sit and when I rise up. You know my going out and my lying down." And I want you to understand, when David writes that, it's a form of Hebrew poetry. And I mentioned this phrase to Annette, and she just sort of rolled my eyes and said, "Oh, that's what you would study in seminary." And I said, "Well, yes." But when David writes this way, what he is doing, I have it on your notes, the principle is you know, totality expressed through polarity. And yeah, that's, I got that phrase in seminary. What that means in a nutshell for common ordinary folks means the sum of everything is described by referring to opposites. So the totality is expressed through polarity. Make sense? Okay. And that's why we see David mentioning sitting and rising, going out, lying down. Those are opposites. Because God knows our thoughts, he knows what we're going to say. And from a human perspective, that can be a little scary. You know, the secret that we know about ourselves that we have never shared with anyone, maybe something that we've done nobody else knows about, or the thoughts we have, or maybe, you know, you have dreams that you've never shared with anyone. God knows all of that. It's not a secret to him at all. I remember a few years ago watching the Alpha videos, and Nikki Gumbel, who is the primary teacher, made a comment, and he talked about how God knows all of our thoughts. And he gave this illustration. He said, imagine somebody had a machine where they could put up on the screen everything you have thought about for the last 2 days. And he said, if that were to happen and somebody got ready to turn the machine on, Nikki Gumbel said, "I'd run out of the building." As I'm sure many of us would do if that would be revealed to everyone. As we go on through Psalm 139, verse 5 says, "You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me." Well, here's another example of opposites. But also that the verse concludes by saying, "You lay your hand upon me." And in Hebrew, that last phrase can refer to blessing another person. You know, if you don't have a relationship with God, his knowledge of you, admittedly, can be a scary thought. But if you do know God in a personal relationship, he knows everything about you in order to bless you. And that's comforting. And that's really the proper response of a believer to the fact that God knows everything about us. Our response should be, as David says in verse 6, "Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain." So his knowledge of us and everything about us is not a scary thing, but it's can be a comforting thing when we know God. The second section, verses 7 through 12, describe God's presence with me, and that's the second blank. Verse 7 says, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?" God is always with us. Theologians simply call that omnipresence. David implies that wherever he goes, God is there. And once again, he illustrates this by referring to opposites. Look at verse 8. It says, and verse 8 is an example of vertical opposites. He says, if I go to heaven, you're there. If I go to the depths, you're there. And the depths refer to Sheol, the place of the dead. So heaven or hell, in a sense. God, you're there. The next verse, verse 9, refers to is horizontal opposites. If you got vertical opposites, then you got horizontal. Verse 9, if I rise on the wings of the dawn, when the sun comes up and it's done, that's in the east. The next phrase is, if I settle on the far side of the sea. Now you have to realize when this was written, when David wrote this, in Israel, whenever anybody referred to the sea, that was always in reference to the Mediterranean Sea, which was to the west of them. And so in verse 9 says, if I flee to the place of the dawn or flee to the sea, you're there. In other words, what David is simply saying is, heaven or hell, you are there. East or west, you are there. And then at the end of this section, he says that, you know, darkness cannot even hide someone from God. Since God is all-knowing and God is present everywhere, God knows what is occurring, even in darkness. And then the good news of God's presence being everywhere is found in verse 10. And that should be our response when we think of the fact that God is everywhere where we are and even beyond. Because verse 10 says, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. And in the Hebrew, when an author refers to the right hand, it's a symbol of strength. So wherever we go, God promises to guide us and strengthen us. And that's what we take assurance when we think of his presence with us. In the third section, verses 13 to 18, describe God's purpose for me. That's the third blank. In addition to creating us, all of our days have been ordained for us in God's plan. And even though we have free will, God is sovereign and he is in control. Theologians have another big term for this. They call that omnipotent. God is all-powerful. But it's his power is what gives our life purpose, gives it meaning, and gives it value. Verse 13 says, for you created my inmost being. And in Hebrew, inmost being literally refers to, interestingly enough, my kidneys. You have to understand, verse 13 literally says, for you created my kidneys. And in ancient Hebrew, that term was used figuratively to refer to the seat or the source of all of our emotions. Okay? You created my inmost being, the inner part of me where all of life springs forth. Now, those of you who are quilters will appreciate the imagery that David uses to picture creation. In verse 13, he says, you knit me together in my mother's womb. Verse 15 says, I was woven together in the depths. And in verse 15, woven together in the depths refers to some of the complex patterns and colors that a weaver would use, using different colors of thread and in a garment or things like that. So David thinks of that weaving picture of God creating us as we're in our mother's womb. And I don't know if you noticed in the very first video that we opened with, that you matter to God, there was a section in there that talked about how God was thinking about us before the creation of the world. And it reminds me of one of my favorite promises in the New Testament, in Ephesians 1, where Paul writes about the fact that before anything existed, before Genesis 1:1 occurred, God's plan was to adopt each of us into his family. Even before anything existed that we know about. Because God created us in love, our lives have purpose. We are not an accident in nature. That means our life has meaning and we have value in the eyes of God. I'm going to talk about more of this in detail in the weeks ahead. But for those people who deny the fact of God as creator, who choose to believe that mankind simply evolved from some slimy mud pit, there really is no purpose in life. Leading atheists have been interviewed, and they've been asked, if you believe in evolution that you came from, you know, a slimy mud pit, what is your purpose in life? And all that they can really say, they admit there is no purpose in life other than simply to survive. And when life is over, they end up going back into the slimy pit. And when you think about that, you know, if you believe in evolution, any meaning in life or any value, you've got to create yourself, as opposed to realizing that there is an all-powerful God that created you out of love. That changes your whole perspective. Because God is all-powerful. David's response and our response to his power, to his omnipotence, is found in verse 17, when David says, "How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them." Goes on to say in the next verse, "Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of the sand. When I awake, you are still with me." When he talks about, you know, the outnumber the grains of the sand, basically he's saying, your thoughts of me, think about it, God's thoughts of you are innumerable. They're beyond measure. They're beyond the ability to even count. And that's what God thinks of you. He loves you and he values you. The last section, verses 19 to 24, I say God describe God's purity to guide us. Now, as you read through Psalm 139, you just really enjoy everything up until verse 19. Verse 19 and the three verses that follow seem like a really abrupt shift in the psalm, and they are. David goes from meditating on God's precious promises and thoughts to hating his enemies and wishing that God would strike these people dead. As I was studying the passage this week, it led, that section of the psalm led one author to say, "I wished David would have ended the psalm at verse 18. And most of us feel that way. And said, I mean, why are these four verses thrown in here when the focus is so much on God's power and his majesty, his presence? What was described, which helped me understand it, was David has just had this grand vision of God's knowledge, his presence, his power in creation. And David is so filled with thoughts of God and wanting to honor God that any thought of evil or sin just repulses him. And he wants nothing to do with it. And so his prayer in those verses is really not so much a desire for revenge or anger, but it's rather an expression of his holy zeal for God. And a fire that will not be quenched. Whether that's right or wrong, it makes sense to me, and I choose to believe that. Because I think David's heart is really shown at the very end. He's responding to how awesome God is and his power. And as he prays about that, he wants to eliminate anything in his life that is a hindrance in his relationship with God. And that's why we come to verses 23 and 24. And he says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me, know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." That's really the focus, I believe, of that last section. He acknowledges sin, wants nothing to do with it, wants to try to eliminate it, and have a heart that's open to the Lord. Let me summarize this psalm, and let's try to apply it to our lives. When you read through Psalm 139, you realize that our finite minds cannot really begin to comprehend that which is infinite. Technically, in one sense, it's impossible. And so in that sense, God is too much for each of us. What you and I do know about God, we know because he's revealed that to us in his word. in his scripture, God's revelation to us is the only way really we know anything about God and how to have a relationship with him. And that's why he sent his son, so that Jesus would show us the way to having a relationship with our Heavenly Father. So as we read through Psalm 139, we realize God is all-knowing, sees everything we do, knows every thought that goes through our mind, knows every word that we utter before we begin speaking. Secondly, God is present everywhere. And there's no direction you can go, up or down, north, south, east, west. God will be there. God of the universe created you. And that means he has a plan for your life. You and I are not an accident of nature. Since God has a plan for your life, that means your life has meaning. He loves you and you have value. Secondly, you know, God is all powerful. Why would he do all of that? Why would he create us? He is all of these things because he loves us. And he has created us so that we would experience life as he designed life to be. And he designed life for each of us so that we would live in relationship with him. What does he want from us? He simply wants verses 23 and 24. He wants us to walk with him, that we would pray the prayer of David in those last two verses and say, search me, know my heart, test me, and then lead me. That's a relationship. Lead me in the way that honors you. My prayer is that your view of God hopefully gets bigger as you read through Psalm 139. It's a great passage to just meditate on and just reflect on maybe this coming week. And as you do, as your vision of God gets better and bigger, may that motivate you to be more intentional in following him. Okay? Let me invite you to stand for a final word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the hope and the promise we find in Psalm 139, where David begins by saying, you've searched me, Lord, you know everything about me. That knowledge is too wonderful for us. You're present everywhere. Your power has been displayed in creation. You're guiding and ordaining the days of my life. Lord, my prayer is that each of us would utter the last couple verses, as David said. Lord, may you search us, show us anything that is a hindrance in our walk with you that would allow us to freely seek you and make you first in our lives as we seek first your kingdom and your righteousness. That is our prayer this day. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Next Sunday, we are going to be looking at probably the most well-known psalm out of the 150, and that is Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, okay? God bless you. You're dismissed.